Good evening, everybody in Wrestling Review Society Facebook page, YouTube page, and wherever you're watching the show tonight. I want to thank everybody for setting a few moments aside from their day to join this interview. We have an absolute legend in the house with us today, and I cannot wait to sit down and pick his brain for the next 45 minutes or so, and you guys are going to enjoy it as well. Just before I bring my guest on, guys, I do want to take one chance to plug all of our amazing sponsors that make this show happen each and every week, first of which being A-Rock Designs. A-Rock Designs is a custom business that makes all those cool wrestling cups you see floating around, like this Bullet Club cup. Keeps your hot drinks hot, your cold drinks cold. Perfect all year round. If you guys want to place any orders, make sure you go to A-Rock Designs on Facebook and place your orders with Ashley Rodriguez. And if you're having trouble finding it, just shoot me a message and I'll send you in the right direction. Also, guys, WASF Championship Belts. WASF Championship Belts is one of the premier belt makers in the world today. If you're looking to start your collection or add to your collection, this is a perfect place to go, and they have payment plans available for any budget. Lastly, guys, we do have our merchandise available. If you go to storefrontier.com/Wrestling Review Society, you'll see all of our amazing merch, like this Halloween Horseman shirt, and like this Wrestle Hub hoodie that I'm wearing. You can get all these things available in short sleeve, long sleeve hoodie, anything you guys need. So go over to storefrontier.com, search Wrestling Review Society, and get your merch today. With that being said, guys, there is no intro that I can give that's going to do this man justice. He has contributed so much to the world of professional wrestling during his time in the business. And he's just got a magnitude of knowledge that I can't wait to hear from. So, guys, without any further ado, the man, the myth, the absolute legend, Mr. Sinn Bodhi. Sinn, how you doing today?
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me. You have two of us. You have your Lord of Weird Sinn Bodhi, and you have Mochi Glackus.
You know, it's funny that you say that, because that's your catchphrase is, you know, the Warlord of Weird, let's get weird. And I feel like the next 45 minutes, we are going to get a little weird, and I'm really looking forward to it.
We just might.
So before we get into wrestling and all that, how's everything going? I know you just returned home. I just saw you at a show in Florida. Obviously, you had a safe trip. How's everything going, man?
It's going for sure. Just trying to always be positive. You know, it's easy to be positive when times are good, but just this whole crazy year is just, I mean, it's definitely one for the books. So, you know, just, you know, I'm in the boat with a ton of other wrestlers, performers, just people, you know, where I think COVID and just all these lockdowns and all these different things really just, guys, my pooches have been quiet this whole time. And now that I'm on with you, we're going to totally, like, they have heat with each other. So anyway,
Sinn, I've got a stampede of kids in the other room. I feel your pain.
I got you. Just trying to think out of the box as per usual, and figure out how to feed my family during these crazy times. You know, the governor here in Nevada has got some pretty heavy duty protocols for performing. So, I mean, so many shows have gone under, just mom and pop businesses, let alone shows. And I'm sure it's like that all across land, across the world. So, you know, for instance, something that I've been doing on the snake pit, and I guess we could talk about that too, but so long and short is, you know, our school page, you know, our Facebook page, it was really just for the students of the school here in Vegas, FSW, snake pit. Our private student page was just, you know, hey, ring crews at this time, hey, flyering teams at this time, classes are at this time, or whatever. So when we all got locked down, I got with Dr. Tom Gangrel, Al Snow, Tyson Dukes, and a good handful of others, Cody Hawk, Truth Martini, just a bunch of guys. And we thought, let's turn that kind of private Facebook page that had maybe, I don't know, 30 or 40 kids on there, and let's turn it into sort of like a cyber locker room and, you know, drop some knowledge for sure. But also too, our prime directive, to use kind of nerd quotes or whatever, was just to really distract people from crawling the walls during a very unknown, very scary time. And I mean, I've gotten tons of messages, just people saying, man, look forward to you guys coming on and just distracting it. Like literally, like all the stuff that you guys are telling us is cool. But just, we just have something to look forward to, which is weird because there's no entertainment, you know, aside from wrestling. And I'm very proud that, you know, WWE and AEW and so forth have, you know, tried to entertain us this entire time, you know, Impact, everybody that's been trying to do stuff, you know, while baseball tapped out, you know, football, hockey, you name it, you know, wrestling still kept on trucking to entertain humans because that's what we do. And so, very, very proud of my industry to do that. And so anyway, so short story long, usually I have no problems, you know, doing match reviews for guys and girls that are, you know, looking for some knowledge. Just whenever I have a minute, I'm happy to do it. I watch matches, give a little notes or whatever. Sometimes I'll do like a watch through and I kind of talk along with it. But in this lockdown, since we've all had time on our hands, and we're not making money otherwise, so I would just kind of charge a donation to literally do like one-on-one match reviews where, you know, somebody would send me their tape. We count it down together, so we're watching it at the same time, and I would literally talk over it and explain, well, try this, a little bit more of this, a little less of this, add to put this over here, you know, this kind of stuff. Do you think about this, or maybe try this, just, you know, stuff like that. And I think
Like virtual
everybody,
coaching.
yeah, yes. And so on the snake pit for free every day, go on, and also too, like, you know, every week we'd have different guest coaches, you know, Rock Riddle, Dr. Tom, Gangrel, you know, you name it, Ezekiel Jackson, Angelina Love, Cody Deaner, just the list goes on and on and on, Pat Buck, you name it, and just dropping some knowledge, and we do it for free. And then we just said, like, you know, but if anybody wants us, like, it's private session stuff, just no exact cost, just throw a couple bucks in the PayPal. You know, an exchange of knowledge for a couple bucks, you know, especially again, like I said, just during these crazy unknown times. And so that's been pretty cool. And then old hobby from yesteryear, you know, I haven't done it in 6 or 7 years, is make those little LJN, those little old wrestling toys from the 80s, like kind of refurbish them or chop shop them and make new little characters and whatever, whatever. So that was a hobby that I had way back in the day, but I just too busy on the road. And now that I have time, when the lockdown first happened, I literally sold my entire, like, have a giant collection, like the full whole, like the complete collection of those things, which is pretty pricey. And I sold it because I wasn't sure of what the landscape was going to be, and I just wanted to be as liquid as possible. And you know, I'm a giant little kid, I like my toys, but it was just more important to me for
Don't
sure.
we all?
Yeah, right. And I just, it was more important to me. What do you got, Moach? She got a little chewy toy. She's trying to show off for me. I'm talking to her. She's like, don't pay attention to that guy. Pay attention to me with my chewy toy. So yeah, I just what was I saying? So just having some time, and I thought, okay, so I sold those toys, you know, just to make sure. To me, it was a little bit more important to take care of my wife and kid than it was to have those toys, you know. But I had a ton of, like, you know, the cheapy ones, like extras, like duplicates, triplicates, quadruplicates, whatever. And so I thought, okay, well, I got time. Maybe I'll just start chop shopping these things and see what I can do with them. And so a hobby kind of turned into also making a few bucks. So I'll sell those things and, you know, take orders, stuff
You
like
just
that.
made
I
some for
literally,
Zick. You just made some for Zicky Dice.
yeah. I did his wedding party, which the guys got a kick out of and stuff. There's another couple that are on the way that I for some other wrestlers and so forth. And then other just fans have messaged me and just say, hey, would you make this guy? Or hey, could you do this or whatever? So I just take orders and make them. And then, God forbid, actually wrestle now that gates are starting to kind of crack open. And I'm fully respectful of COVID. I'm, you know, a very healthy person, very sanitary. As a tattoo guy too, I, you know, in multiple states, I've always had to do all those, you know, take courses on, like, you know, bloodborne pathogens, cross contaminations, and sterilization, and all that kind of stuff.
Absolutely.
That was always my fallback thing. Like I do it, I still do it, but I just figured, you know, maybe wrestle for however long. Knock on wood, you know, I stay uninjured. I'm not old, but I'm not young either. So, like, how long can I do it? So, tattoos and all that, and coaching is definitely, you know, backup plans and whatnot. So anyway. Just as I travel, you know, I kind of, the tattoo artist in me just knows, you know, sanitize this, do that, and not doing, I'm an outlaw. I don't do anything because I'm told to do it. I do it because I think I should do it. And the only time I'm told to do something is when I don't have a choice. I would much rather, arrive at my own conclusion that it's a good idea to wear a mask. It's a good idea to do this. It's a good idea to do that. I just don't want to be told. And so I've sort of been griping and having a bit of a hard time about being told what to do. I don't, especially when, yeah, I mean, I want this to be about wrestling. I don't want this to be about politics, but I just, 2020 has been very frustrating. So I think, you grit your teeth, you pull your boots up and you do what you got to do to feed your families. And that's that. You try to make it as enjoyable as possible. Like when I get in that ring, as Jake the Snake would say, the only place it doesn't hurt is in the ring. And so I'm very much in that mindset where like I can't wait to fly out. I always miss my family the second I fly out, but I love to do what I do, and then I come home and I'm super happy to be home. And I stay home for a little bit and then I fly out or drive out. Again, sorry, as I always say, my daily apology for being too stupid to know how to turn off my notifications while I'm talking. So if you hear ding and ding, my bad.
Nah, it's all good. There's a lot that you said in that. There's a lot that we covered in that answer. And first and foremost, for someone who's been in the business as long as you have and has the knowledge that you have, it's amazing to see how willing you are to give back. And COVID hit, and you didn't let that stop you from teaching. You didn't let that stop you from giving back. So it's just a great thing to see. But for those who don't know, how long have you been involved with professional wrestling?
Oh boy, I'm going into my 22nd year, and literally, I just maybe it was about a month or so ago now, and I was doing this podcast, and we were talking about it, and I kind of had to do the math and realize, like, going into my 22nd year as a pro wrestler, but I'm going into my 38th year as a martial artist. I was in grade four when I took my first karate lesson, and so I physically, know my craft, and I'm always learning. Like, I'm always eyes and ears wide open. I always want to get better. I'm always down for critique. And I just noticed that, during my journey, a lot of the old school guys just really didn't want to give up any knowledge. They were scared to lose a spot or whatever they were thinking. And anytime that somebody did give you a bit of knowledge, it was like kind of giving you half of a toy with no instructions. So you really had a lot to figure out, even when they did give you something. It's so esoteric and this and that. So I kind of thought, well, I love wrestling. It's going to be here when I'm long gone. So I would love to give back to it as much as I can. And I'm a super duper huge fan. That's why I got in wrestling in the first place. So I love this business, sport, art, whatever you want to call it. And I just thought that's my way of paying it forward. Like I'm always like 90% of the time you'll find me at a show, you'll find me behind the curtain watching, in case young guys and girls want any advice. Like I'm not a know-it-all that walks over at everybody after a match because you know what you should do. I'm not that guy. I watch because I like to watch. And then if somebody comes over and asks me something, an opinion, a suggestion, a critique, or whatever, then I've done them the respect of watching, so I'm not just talking out of my ass.
Absolutely. And like I said, I just saw you in Florida at the ARW show, and you were very much like Sting in the rafters, just floating around, observing everything. And you're always somewhere, or you can always be found, and you really do seem like you're just a fan today, as you've always been. But being in the wrestling business over 20 years, how has wrestling, or how do you feel wrestling has evolved since then? What are some of the changes you've seen in pro wrestling from the time you came in to now, and the evolution of pro wrestling as a whole?
Well, all right, here we go. So in some, I like to crack my jokes. I think it's my right as an old fart to crack my jokes. But I do very much look at myself kind of like that same mindset of Johnny from Cobra Kai, not the movie, but for the TV show where I just, so if you've watched that, if you kind of get the joke that I'm trying to, make, I think I'm happy for things to change. I'm not afraid of evolution. I'm not afraid of being progressive, and I'm not a back in my day. I'm not that guy, not old school. I'm not new school. I feel like Bruce Lee. I feel like Jeet Kune Do. I feel like water. Be fluid. Water is versatile. Water is strong and soft. It bends and moves and it hits solid. It knows how to morph and flow. And I think if the old school guys were to drop some knowledge and the new school guys and girls were to embrace that knowledge and weave it into their newer ideas, I think that would only benefit the industry. But I think when old timers are stingy with their knowledge and young people are too obtuse to like, they can know it all. Like, I know how to do a moonsault. What else do I need to know? You know, I think communication definitely goes both ways. So if there's that perfect storm of communication when the young guys and girls open their ears and the old farts open their mouths, I think, you know, there's a great exchange and it only helps our industry. And I think, you know, I love wrestling. I love high flying. I love kick punch. I love strong style. I love Memphis walk and talk. I love British catch as catch can wrestling, like Euro style of wrestling. I love Lucha Libre, you know, even some of the hardcore stuff. I like it all. Even some of the comedy stuff. Weirdly, I'll tell you a little side note. Like, I'll be watching, you know, on a show, and then I'll see a couple of wrestlers do some haha spot, and they'll come over to me afterwards and say, "Hey, what did you think of our little comedy schnavitz?" And I'll tell them, to be honest, I'm not a big fan of comedy wrestling. And they go, What do you mean? Like, you're the freaks of wrestling guy. Like, what the heck? Look, you got bunnies and duckies on your boots. What the heck are you talking about? And I just sort of explained to them, like, well, yeah, that's fine. And yeah, freak show is sort of its own little weird little universe, you know, whatever. But just as far as like, that's a very niche show. But like 9 out of 10 shows I do are basically, like, for lack of a better term, sports entertainment style shows, straight shows, for lack of a better term. Right, Moj? She's squeaking to confirm what I'm telling you. So, you know, within those shows, those are mostly PG-13 kind of shows. You know, there's kids there, whatever. It's not just like drunk hipsters at a 21 plus show. Like, again, that is even still a kind of an avant-garde show. That's a niche style of show. Like, the brunt of shows are family shows.
I kind of see Freak Show more like a variety show because you have things other than just wrestling going on.
It is, but it is definitely built to an adult audience, not so much as for kids. And like, the funny stuff is definitely just to make the hipsters kind of giggle and all that stuff. But how I look at it is like, you know, if there is a funny moment in a match, like, I'm not setting out to do a comedy show or a comedy match. I think a match is a match. Not to be caught up in like semantics or anything. I just think like, if I'm going to go out there, I want to give them a variety of emotions, a roller coaster of emotions. Like, if I went out there and was just all silly, then I'd be a buffoon and there'd be no threat. Lovey, can you hand me that bottle of water? Thank you. And thank you, darling. My loving wife, Karen. There she is.
How are you?
How is you? How are you?
I am doing good.
There she is, doing good. Thank you for asking.
Well, thank her for allowing me to have a few moments with you on your very few days off.
It's all good. All good. So, again, I think, like, if I was to go out there and just be all silly, then people would go, okay, well, he's a buffoon. There's no heat. There's no worry, you know. Or if I was to go out there and be too cool for school and all serious, it could get dry really quick. And the more really shooty that it is, it could almost, you know, that's over very quick in real life. Real life fight does not last long. So we elongate things for sports entertainment's sake, for entertainment's sake. But I think if we take them on that emotional roller coaster, we're like, is he messing around? Is he scary? Is he funny? Could he bite my face off? Like, I don't, like, he's fun to watch, but I don't want to mess with that guy. You know, if I keep you on your toes, okay, love you. You know, that way people are engaged and on their toes, and I start making them internally ask questions like, well, what's this guy up to? What's he doing? What's he thinking? Why did he do this? I don't want to mess with him. I would mess with him or whatever, you know, and so forth. So it's basically like a cerebral playground, I think. Like, I don't look at matches like matches with moves and spots. I look at them as stories with moments. And if there's going to be a funny moment, a scary moment, a sexy moment, a serious moment, whatever, a holy shit moment, then so be it. If that makes any kind of sense. So that's, so going back to the, you know, a couple of guys asking me, hey, what'd you think about my comedy spot? Like, I think if you look so collaborative, then it just plays as phony baloney. And so many people are in such a rush to just chop down something. And I don't get that. Like, you know, you see so much, you know, I don't know, for lack of a better term, just hatred online. Like, if you don't like wrestling, carving it, why are you watching it? You know,
exactly.
Like all these armchair quarterbacks just squawking, I don't believe this, you know, whatever, whatever. Like, I just picture the comic book guy from The Simpsons, you know, like, oh, when Dolph Ziggler gets to the ring, this looks like a job for Ghost Rider or Aquaman, possibly Wonder Woman. Like,
you know, like, that's awesome.
You know, and I'm a comic nerd, so I can say that, you know.
No, it's great. I love how animated you are and how you get into your stories. Just being able to sit here and pick your brain for just a little, for any length of time is absolutely awesome for me as a wrestling fan. I want to bring up some of the viewer comments because there's a lot of them.
Just to cap that off, just to put an ending on that little bit of schnabitz there, is like I would try to explain to people, like, well, if I do something funny, I properly dispatch my heel or my baby face first. So, like, I always kind of use the go-to of, like, Joker doesn't just go up and squirt Batman in the face with a water gun and go squirt, 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 tee hee, or why wouldn't Batman just punch him in the face? So Joker has got to blindside him with a cinder block and then hit him with a bucket of acid and then run over him with a clown car. And then while Batman is really, really selling and really hurting, then he squirts Batman in the face with a water gun and goes tee hee hee. That's where Joker's looking for that's where he's looking for the laugh. So that's how I kind of feel about it. I want to respect my opponent, so that way, win, lose, or draw, we both are made. We both walk out of there with, you know, maybe if I'm the heel, I walk out with more heat. I'm the baby, I walk out with more steam, and vice versa for my dance partner.
Absolutely. So going into the next question that I have for you, I just want to bring up some of these because, I mean, these are my words, but these are a lot of other people's words, and you're a super humble guy, so you won't admit this, but a lot of our viewers, you know, are saying Sinn Bodhi is an absolute legend. One of your always favorites, even during your Kazarni run. And then we have Piers Austin, who is a really good friend of mine who runs a similar show. He says the same thing. So for all of your fans to look at you as such a legend and such a great mind for the business, you brought up earlier the Snake Pit, where you are a trainer, you're involved in training people and coaching them and stuff like that. So what does a guy like you look for in a student when they walk into the Snake Pit, when they say, I want to be a pro wrestler? What do you look for in that person?
The very, very first thing is heart. You know, I've sat there many a time at ringside or just wherever with Jake, Jake the Snake, who is one of my absolute best pals, my brother, coach, mentor, idol, opponent, friend, you know, and
fantastic promo,
awesome stick man, best psychologist in the world, if you ask me. And so he would let, you know, we'd sit there and tell some kids like, hey, at our school, like, you know, between Jake, Sin, D'Lo, Kenny King, you know, all the different coaches that we have come in and out of there, like, we can teach you damn near every trick in the book. Can't teach you this. You need to bring this. So if you're like little thin skinned, whatever, and you come there thinking you're just going to get showered with compliments, like, we're not going to tell you stuff the shits and you're awful and nothing like that. We're going to be nice to you, but we are going to critique you honest. We're going to respect you enough to tell you straight. So if you get all boo-boo faced and look like you're going to, you know, cry, there's no crying in baseball, no crying in wrestling. So like, you got to kind of have thick skin. You can't be, you know, I just, again, not going to politics or anything, like I pride myself on being nice. I enjoy to be nice. I want to be nice. Same time, I don't believe in 27th place trophies. You know, I don't believe in hand holding. I believe in helping. I definitely believe in being Mr. Miyagi as opposed to Cobra Kai, all to contradict my stance on Johnny from Cobra Kai. Like, we're there to help. And I think it's the coach's privilege and honor to give the right knowledge to people that come in and are hungry enough and crazy enough to follow their dreams. But those people have to be open-minded enough and thick-skinned enough to go, oh, I need to work on this. Oh, I need to work on that. Okay, as opposed to just, hey, where's my truckload of compliments? You know, I've seen so many guys where you tell them, hey, you know, I don't know about this. Maybe try that. You know, you're less than complimentary. And then just kind of like, they look like they're going to tear up. You know, mm-hmm. And I mean, I'm a passionate guy. I get it. But that would just make me have grit to be like, oh, yeah, I'm going to show you. I'm going to like dig deep. I'm going to, you know, fight from the bootstraps, as we would say, and fix what we need to fix and make it amazing. Not entitled. Like, I'm entitled to nothing. I'm 22 years in. So if some kid in 3 months thinks he's entitled to whatever, like, this business owes me nothing. I owe it everything. And I think that's a rude awakening for a younger flock of humans trying to do this or anything that, the tough get going and all that stuff.
Yeah. And you were saying, you can spend all this time coddling somebody and telling them like, oh, it was great. But if you never address the problem, how are they going to get any better? You have to be able to be upfront with them.
Well, and here's the thing. It's like, so if I coddle you, I am doing you no service whatsoever. I'm doing you a disservice. I'm insulting you, because if you were to go have a tryout at the PC in Orlando, AEW, Impact, ROH, CMLL, AAA, New Japan, wherever, and we didn't tell you anything useful, we're just like, yeah, you're awesome, and gave you no criticism, and then you get thrown in the deep end and you bury yourself because you think your shit don't stink, but you're the shits, how is that helping your dream? How did we help you? How did we help arm you for what you were in for? Which is a very uphill climb, but if we over prepare you, then when you go in there and you can nail the physical trials and tribulations of a tryout, if you can nail the cerebral and psychological trials and tribulations of a tryout, if you have your handle on psychology, if you can have a work rate, if you can actually work. And to, again, my Homer Simpson quote was old enough, but I'll give you an even older quote. This is a Chasing Amy quote. Yes, I can memorize things or whatever, but I'm a penciler, not a tracer. So if anybody has ever seen that movie, if you want to know what I mean, just go watch that movie. It's a good movie, so you'll be entertained whether you're watching it as a little old me or not. But, wrestlers can memorize stuff. Okay, no problem. You can memorize whatever you want. To me, the more I have to memorize, the less fun it is, the less organic it is, the more rigid it is, and the more house of cards it is, easily those cards can fall. But if you go out and work and feel, and we can have some stuff along the way, a bunch of things, some things, hardly any things, no things, and we work into it organically, then we're not worrying about what next, and we're kind of phoning in the now. We are only focused on the now and putting in the details that the fans paid their hard-earned money to see. You're a grown-ass man. You're not a little kid. I can entertain you as a little kid, and I can blow your mind going, what happened? What did just happen? That's an easier sell, but you as a grown-ass man, you were a little kid that loved wrestling, and now you're an adult. Now your perception is a little more educated and whatever. So it's still my job to entertain you, to turn you back into a little kid and go, holy crap, I don't know how they did that. Or, oh my gosh, that was crazy. Or that was really fun. Or that guy was scary. Or that guy was funny. Or this or that, or this or that. So where we are, again, we're playing with emotions and we're telling stories. If you went to go see a Star Wars movie and you just saw cool lasers and cool costumes for 2 hours with no rhyme or reason why it was tied together, it would just look like a 2-hour rock video. And as cool visually as it would be, you'd be taken out of it very, your interest would be taken out of it very swiftly. It is the story that binds it together. So it's our job to look cool, look the part, do cool things like, swing a lightsaber, fight space monsters, fight stormtroopers, do all sorts of cool stuff. But without that story, without that work rate, it's just going to be a house of cards, or a very best dumb luck stringing it together. It just accidentally made it whatever, because nobody is a mind reader. So how do I know at the 8-minute, 27-second mark, we're going to find this lightning? We're going to work to that. We're working to 8 minutes and 20 seconds. 27 seconds with the fans, you're going to just lose their minds. We don't know that. So no, if we absolutely go out, we can propose, but if we're working this stuff and then we hear the fans really bite and we're working as opposed to memorizing, we can really, really maximize those moments and get those characters that much more over, get those characters that much more heat, have the fans that much more emotionally invested in those characters.
Absolutely, and I can't say it any better than Facebook user did right here. Guys, we are using the platform StreamYard. If you want your name and photo to pop up, click the link above my head. Go to StreamYard/Facebook. Grant them permission to use your name and your photo. But like he said, facts from a legend. I could not say that any better myself. Now, everybody watching seems to have a pretty good idea of who you are, but for that second-day wrestling fan, for those new fans who may have just started getting into wrestling, Sinn has wrestled everywhere, WWE, TNA, just to name a few. He still wrestles today. We talked earlier, you're getting on a flight in the morning to go fly out somewhere to wrestle. What's next for Sinn? Like, what's next for Sinn Bodhi? What do you look forward to when you wake up in the morning? What goal drives you? because you've done it all, man.
Well, you know, as far as I'm concerned, I'm just scratching the surface. So like, I'm just getting started. I'm as hungry, if not hungrier now than on my very first day at pro wrestling, or even to rewind further than that, like when I was a little kid watching, like I was so enamored. And like guys like Edge and Christian, who I grew up with, will tell you, like, it was a mad dash to get to that variety store, that video store, when only, you know, two or three copies of VHS copies of, you know, WrestleMania or Best of WWF Volume 2 was coming out. And it was a mad scramble to get to that video store before any other kid in your hometown. And so it was like Jeopardy, like we had to go get it, where now everybody could just click a button and everything is on their phone. So there's like, oh, I'll watch it later. So I think we just grew up in a time that really, what's the word I'm looking for? That really cultivated an urgency to be passionate, an urgency to be urgent, as opposed to, yeah, I'll watch it later, or I'll check it out on the replay or whatever. Like, there was no replay. Like, you missed it if you didn't see it live.
You didn't have DVR.
Right. No DVRs. You know, at best, we could, you know, duct tape two VCRs together and put a little piece of tape over one of the video tapes and, you know, MacGyver or making a copy for somebody. And that was some super high tech space age stuff back in, you know, the wheel was still square when, you know, me and Edge and Christian and stuff were still doing that as little kids. So everybody's, and also too, like, I mean, I want to say half of my matches are just in the ether because there was no cell phones to record stuff. So unless I got a copy of something, which so many of my older things that I'm very proud of, or just were just great memories, like, you know, maybe some early stuff I could watch back, go, oh, that was the shits, what was I thinking, you know? But it's all grainy and pixelated. Like when you put filters on stuff, when you're editing something on your editing suite at home and you put those old janky filters on it to look like it's the 70s or whatever, like that's what our old footage looks like legit. It's boxed videotapes, you know, from 15, 20 years ago or whatever. Like some of that stuff that I have from Memphis was just recorded off of a TV and given to me by a fan from a videotape and then transferred over to a computer. And like, if you go on YouTube to my YouTube page, Freak Show Wrestling, and you'll see like those syndiculousness episodes, which is kind of like little road story clips. That was another thing that I did just for the past time and during the lockdowns and just to entertain humans and entertain myself. And so I could stomach to kind of put like little tiny clips from those old janky VHS tapes, like Wrestling Lawler or the Road Warriors or Dusty and just all sorts of stuff. And like the footage would just be unwatchable because it was so grainy, like to watch a whole match, but just to put fun little clips, you know, into sort of like a little variety kind of like recap kind of show, whatever you want to call that syndiculousness. But, you know, but now all these guys have these awesome HD cameras on their phones. They can record so much stuff. They can record promos. They can send links and photos to promoters, easy peasy. You know, we had to like spend a ton of money, you know, making 8x10s, mailing out 8x10s and resumes and videotapes and all that jazz. So there was just a semblance of urgency back in the day. And I think it's rare to see it. It's there. I'm not so jaded where I don't think it's not in existence now. I think there's a lot of guys and girls that have a whole lot of want to, as the old timers would say. I think it's just a lot more rare now, which, you know, may or may not be a good thing. I mean, that definitely lets the cream rise to the top. So, you know, I'm very proud watching my industry grow and morph and adapt. I'm very proud to have done some coaching, you know, for the company that I love since I was a little kid. You know, so imparting knowledge on some of those guys and girls, just amazing, and watching them, and they are hungry, you know, or a good portion of them are hungry. And those ones that are hungry, you can tell the difference between the ones that aren't.
Absolutely. Sinn, I know you have to, I know you're flying out in the morning for a show. You got some family time you need to get to. So I want to be respectful of your time, but I do have one final segment that I think you're really going to enjoy that all of our viewers seem to like. I call it the Insta game. Basically what I do is I look at your Instagram. I get a few pictures.
I'm sorry. Before we do this, let me just take a quick second and just say thank you guys for popping up. And I see those comments, and I really do appreciate you all. And I am very humbled and flattered that you guys, you know, are dialed in and are tuning in. And yes, Chasing Amy is awesome. I can see your guys pop up. It's just sometimes it's popping up so quick that I can't read the full thing, which I'm super appreciative of. So I just want to say thank you guys for watching, and thank you guys for caring. That I, as cheesy as it sounds, I swear it is from the bottom of my heart. That is like what every wrestler lives for. You know, you can hear all sorts of like compliments and insults online. Like if you go onto Twitter or something like that, sometimes the insults are funny, and sometimes the compliments are stupider than the insults, you know? So to actually have like wrestling fans that just enjoy wrestling and just are enjoying that people are busting their asses to entertain you is super duperly appreciated. And I really do care about you all. Thank you.
And they love you too, Sin. One of our avid viewers watches every show, is always here liking, commenting. He's a big fan of yours. His name is Daniel Smith. He's from across the
What's
pond.
Up? Here's my shout out to Daniel Smith. I see you on my page right there.
Awesome.
Did I just prematurely jump on what you were about to say?
You know, when you have a mind as sharp as yours, you know what I'm going to say before I even say it. So I'm not cutting off a legend.
So bam, there you go.
So like I was saying, Sin, this is the only reoccurring segment we have. I call it the Insta Game. I take a look at your Instagram. I find a few pictures that I think are cool. I put them up on the screen, and I get your thoughts behind it. Are you down with that?
Sure.
Okay, so first one that I thought was really cool, and you've kind of hit on it throughout this entire interview, but WWE Network recently released, you know, the FCW documentary, and we saw this. A younger Sinn Bodhi being taught by Dr. Tom Pritchard. So,
look at how good looking I am. Jeez Louise. Anyway, go ahead. All right. Distracted.
What was your time like in FCW and being able to learn from Dr. Tom, Dusty, Norman Smiley, and all those guys down there at that facility?
Man, I was a kid in a candy shop. Now, I loved learning from the wrestling coaches, but the business was still looking at developmental, kind of like the, you know, like the weirdo stepchild kind of a thing. So it wasn't quite well received just yet. Now like NXT and everything is so well received by the WWE office and by the fans and so forth, where it was very prehistoric version of that at that time. It was a very stressful time, just again, because people didn't really know exactly what it was and this and that, but you know, in the ring, I had a blast learning from Doc and Dusty and Steamboat and Kern and Smiley and Kidman and all these different guys was just super awesome. Yeah, I mean, I loved it for sure. And I learned a ton. You know, I really did learn a ton. And it was funny because there'd be guys like myself, Colt Cabana, Heath Slater, Offa Jr., Tyson Kidd, TJ Wilson, guys like that that were fairly experienced before we ever even got there. So we would kind of be sort of like the Bull Durham to a lot of the meat that they had there, like some of these big, huge, like giant jacked up monsters that were green and, you know, Dusty or so forth. They're like, baby, I ain't getting in it with that big old look at that guy. I ain't getting in there. No way. Thin Bodhi, you go show that boy how to wrestle down, young man, if you will. Get your ass kicked, if you will, because I ain't doing it there, bro. He's like, yes, sir, Mr. Green. So
that's awesome.
And that was really educational for us to do that. Like, you know, I want to say way back in the day, I probably had the galaxy's shittiest dark match because I got an opportunity when I was so green and so ill prepared. Like, I could have been pulled through a match if somebody that knew anything of what they were doing could have called me through it. But I was so green and they put me in with an even greener guy that was very nervous and he was huge and jacked. And I just didn't have the experience to know how to move him when he got nervous. When you get nervous, you get deaf and you get very rigid. And now I can move a guy like that in my sleep. And doing that at FCW, I really learned a ton of how to do that at FCW. But it's just everything is a learning curve. And everything makes you better if you embrace knowledge. Like if you get comfortable with being uncomfortable, stepping out of your comfort zone, taking chances, and so forth. So. I think I made a career on being uncomfortable, so I enjoy it.
Well, I absolutely love your style of match, your approach to matches. I love that uncomfortable feeling, and very few guys do it as well as you do. The next photo I wanted to show you, you know, going along those uncomfortable lines, there are times as a fan where we look at wrestling matches and we just ask ourselves, how did we get here? And that is my question with this photo, Sinn. How did you get here?
Oh, you know, if I had a nickel.
I mean, those are darts in your chest, by the way.
Yeah, there's just as many of them in my chest as there is in my back. You just can't see the other side of that photograph. So early into my pro wrestling career, I was invited to be a circus strongman. And so I wasn't so much the guy lifting the 1,000-pound barbell. I was more of a pain tolerance guy. Not a macho guy, but I have a very high threshold, a very Mick Foley-esque threshold. And I was shown how to be a human dartboard amongst a ton of other weird things. And I remember thinking it'd be a, you know, it was just something I never thought I would do, run off and join the circus, but it was something I always fantasized about. I just never thought I would get the opportunity to do it. And then once I started wrestling, and soon after that, I had this opportunity. And, you know, a few little birds had told me that Vince McMahon liked circus and sideshow and all that kind of stuff. So I thought, well, this might bode well as sort of a double whammy if I get an opportunity to be seen. And sure enough, that's one of the things that got me hired, was doing that kind of stuff. Well, I actually did that on pay-per-view, on one of those weekly NWA TNA pay-per-views as part of the New Church. And they sort of put it over as like, oh, this new guy is going to do this crazy thing that might just be too racy for pay-per-view. And it's so dangerous and so graphic and all this stuff. And we did it, and it was a lot of fun. I know how to do a ton of weird things like that. And I learned, so at that carnival, that sideshow was Carnival Diablo. They're based in Canada. And then, I learned a ton of tricks from there. And then, after my release at WWE, I actually went on to work with the Jim Rose Circus, and I had my own sideshow troupe, which was the Dynamite Death Monkeys. And that was sort of the precursor to Freak Show Wrestling, where, you know, I was just kind of frustrated and just kind of blowing off steam and just doing some of the ornerier stuff that a PG environment wouldn't allow me to do. And, but I've really, since then, I've really just realized it wasn't so much as PG. I need interest. You know, I can do interesting within the realm of PG or 21 plus or whatever, but I just need interesting. I need to be engaged. I need to be amused. I feel very much like in that Andy Kaufman mindset of I'm not so much worried of what the average bear is going to think. I think that I've traveled so bizarrely and seen so many odd things that if something amuses me, it'll probably by proxy amuse the average bear. So that to me is sort of like the Andy Kaufman mindset. If it amused him, he would do it. He wasn't trying to make anybody else happy. He just thought, well, if this tickles me, it'll probably tickle somebody else. So that's how I kind of jumped into the sideshow.
It definitely tickled me when I seen it. And like I said, it just left me asking, how did we get here? Now, I have one final photo I want to get your thoughts on. And you have many, many amazing pictures on your Instagram. I advise anybody to go check out Sinn Bodhi's Instagram page and just take a look at some of the amazing things he's done and the photos he's had and moments he's captured. But as a collector, this one really stood out to me. Recently, you got to do a tour with Dave Milliken himself.
Yeah,
as a collector yourself, what was it like being able to be there with him and see everything that he has?
Oh man, I was like a kid in a candy shop. He got the private tour of his home and his private workshop. And I mean, he's got such cool thing. I felt like I was in, you know, 85. Like I felt like a little kid. It was awesome. Like I want to say he had, stuff from the Fabulous Ones, stuff from Jerry Lawler, you know, Boogie Woogie, all these different dudes, and like boots, robes, a shit ton of belts. Just, it was just amazing. Like, and he's a great dude. I've known Dave since my days working for Lawler in Memphis that go back to about 04, 05-ish, 04, 05, 06, 07-ish. And so he was always there, and he's just a good dude. And I sort of reconnected with him on those Rocket City shows in Hazelwood, Alabama. Again, another great show. It's now an affiliate of OVW where I work a lot. I'm very proud of Barry Koloff and his Rocket City promotion. He's a great guy. And he brought me over to Dave's as kind of a surprise, and I thought it was just awesome. He's like, hey, man, I haven't seen you in a long time. And so it was cool that we got to kind of reunite. And now when I go down and work on the regular for Rocket City, you know, he's there and I get to see him. And I get to play with his belts. So it's cool. You know, it's awesome. Some of those photos that I took right around probably on my Instagram, probably a photo or two left or right or up or down from the one that you just pulled of me and Dave. There's me holding like the old NWA titles and the old Lawler's old title from the USWA and all these different things. Rock and Roll's very first title belts, like the real ones, which I was totally like nerding out because I'm a giant kid and it was amazing. So, you know, just this whole business just lets me be the giant child that I am and eternally grateful. It has let me see wonderful places, meet wonderful people, do really crazy fun things. You know, more so like, you know, people say Spalding or Joker or whatever, but weirdly, I kind of look at myself more like Ultron. I feel sort of like this bizarre satellite that's just floated out into space and accrued a ton of very eclectic knowledge and then came back to wreak havoc everywhere. That's sort of how I can look at it.
Yeah, I couldn't imagine how it would feel as a fan to be sitting there in the mothership, quote unquote, of collections and the holy grails that man has. But you know, Sinn, I do want to be respectful of your time. I know you're flying out pretty early in the morning. So just before we get out of here, Sinn, please allow everybody to know where they can find you, follow you, keep up with you and everything you've got going on.
Sure. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram is all Sinn Bodhi, SinnBodhi. Links to my YouTube page or I want to say in the little bios of my Twitter and my Instagram, and I guess also on my Facebook, but it's Freak Show Wrestling, all one giant word. And it's got a little eyeball, cartoon eyeball icon on for the YouTube page. So you can see that. And it's got mostly a lot of like promos, matches, stuff like that. A lot of weird, just bizarre, fun stuff. And you can see that I'm a very moody performer. So I think like, as you see a promo or a match or whatever, I think you kind of see, oh, he felt silly that day. Oh, he was grumpy that day. Oh, he was angry. Oh, he was sad. Oh, he was playful. Like, I think I kind of wear it on my sleeve. So, you know, being a wrestler is sort of an artistic outlet. I am Sinn. Nick is Sinn. It's oddly intertwined. Like, again, my good buddy Edge, I'll parallel with, like, I'm right in the middle between Edge and Jake, where Jake is 99.99% Jake the Snake and 0.001% Aurelian Smith. Edge is Edge in the ring and Adam Copeland everywhere else. He is very adamant that is a character he is playing. Whereas me, I think I'm kind of somewhere in between them. I'm very 50-50. You know, Sinn and Nick are very intertwined in some ways. Of course, I love Nick's life, but at the same time, Sinn Bodhi has a pretty fun go of it, you know, and so forth. So it just, sometimes it's an easier place to be. It's less awkward. You know, my wife sort of put it over to me. She kind of opened my eyes a couple of years ago. And she just looked at me and said, you know, I think you're an extroverted introvert. I go, what do you mean? She goes, well, you're crazy in the ring, but then, you know, when you get out of the ring, you're not trying to party and be all loud and obnoxious. You're pretty quiet, you know, polite, you know, very quiet person. And so I guess I'm like, okay, I mean, I guess that makes sense. I can buy that. You know, she's beautiful, but she's just as clever. So, you know, I take a lot of her opinions and so forth. It's very cathartic to me to see her point of view on things because maybe, you know, surrounded by ropes and turnbuckles, I'm pretty slick. I'll say that humbly, I know my shit. I always learn. I'm always learning, but I know my shit. But it's always cool to have another opinion and so forth. It's up in an opinion that you trust. So maybe I can leave you guys with that, that, you know, as you're aspiring to be a wrestler or if you're a wrestling fan or you're just aspiring to do whatever it is. You want to be an astronaut, race car driver, ballerina, accountant, plumber, lawyer, G.I. Joe, whatever you want to be. It's probably a good idea to have one or two people that you trust that you can bounce thoughts off of unregulated so you can get honest feedback from people and not just have people sort of yes man you or just placate you and just give you the hard truth when like if I do something and I'll ask Ed, what do you think of that, he'll tell me, he's like, oh, that was awesome or that was a shits, you know, he'll tell you straight out, like he's not going to pull any punches or neither will Jake, you know. And I don't want it any other way. Like I don't want to walk over to somebody, oh, it was my match, oh, it was lovely, you know. I want to know when I'm asking. And that's something too for the younger wrestlers. Like, the coaches would kind of joke, like, we can tell when you're trying to get over with us versus when you're trying to improve yourself. So like some of the younger guys are walking around like, what'd you think? You know, like, oh, it was awesome. That's an insult. If you hear, oh, that was awesome, that was great, nothing else, that's an insult. But if they come over, hey, what did you think about this and that? And they ask about specifics, and you can go down a rabbit hole with them and talk about details, like devil into details. All the
When
little
they
things
start
are
to
the
dissect it.
yeah. And we can go down those rabbit holes no problem all day long. But yeah, anytime you roll up on a coach, he's like, how was my match? You know, like, it was awesome. So there's that.
So, Sin, thank you so much for making the time. Thank you so much for setting a few moments of your day out to talk to us. Thank you, everybody who tuned in and watched. This has been this week's episode of The War Room. We will be live Thursday at 7 p.m. this coming Thursday with another pro wrestling interview. And I wanted to make one more quick shout out to our newest sponsor, somebody that we are very happy to be partnering with, Real Pro Wrestling. Guys, go to Real Pro Wrestling on YouTube, check out some of their content. You'll see some collaborations between myself and them coming in the near future. Real Pro Wrestling on YouTube. Make sure you check those guys out. Another shout out to A-Rock Designs and Wasef Championship Belts. For any belts or custom merchandise, go to those places and check them out. Sin, if I can just have one more second of your time when I kill the live feed, I would really appreciate it. And guys, we will see you next week for another episode of The War Room. Thanks, guys.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
So light up.